Here this weekend for Air Expo from Ypsilanti, Michigan. This premier close air support aircraft supports the Navy, the Marines, the Air Force, and the Army, as well as Allied forces anywhere, anytime. First flown back in May of 1972, over 700 A-10s have been produced and continue to fly, as well as the 122nd Fighter Wing and the 163rd Fighter Squadron of the Indiana Air National Guard. Very proud to present today's opening to our flying display here at Air Expo 2021. Appreciate your ongoing cooperation. Currently, it's way in to the right. You'll see the small yellow aircraft. This is known as the Beechcraft T-34 Mentor. It was a primary trainer for the United States military, both the Army, the Air Force, the Navy, and really all of the branches to provide that of introductory flight during the 1950s.
Ladies and gentlemen, from high and to your right, once again, we welcome to Air Expo 2021 from the Maryland and Indiana Air National Guard, the A-10 Thunderbolt 2s.
These A-10s have proven themselves in multiple combat operations over the past several decades, including combat operations in that of Afghanistan.
Much harder to hear, and allows it to achieve tactical surprise when attacking from all attitudes. The Warthog, of course, built to simply take heavy damage and remain flying. A-10s just like these have returned from combat severely damaged but still flyable. And that's a testament to the strength and durability of America's premier frontline attack aircraft. You'll see those vertical fins on the tails there, and they actually kind of shift as well. Make the airplane, again, very durable and keeps away from potential FOD, that's foreign object debris, when operating from shorter unapproved airstrips. Crew and assets from the United States Air Force and other military branches utilized approved aviation events, much like Air Expo this weekend, not only to showcase off their aircraft and their mission, but also to provide necessary training flight hours and requirements. By the Super Marine Spitfire Mark 9.
that they're looking at.
Lieutenant Colonel Doolittle considered the raid to be a failure at first, and in retrospect, it actually did very little damage. And with the loss of some of his men,
does not feature that dome. It actually features a variety of Browning machine guns up on the nose, and it gave this airplane a lot of firepower, especially down low, when they would utilize it for those low-level naval strafing attacks. This B-25 we're seeing today was actually delivered to the U.S. Army Air Force right after the B-25 contract was terminated, so it was actually flown directly out of the ground in storage in six areas of the Arctic and the Northwest Territories of Canada. Helping professionals make confident decisions and run better businesses. Their mission is to help professionals advance their businesses with trusted answers only they can provide. Wings of the North thanks them for their support since 2006, serving as a lead partner for Expo since 2008. We want to say thanks to Rewilding Services, an industry leader, providing reliable and responsible recycling and waste disposal services to their customers. Wings of the North thanks... said, no, I will build you something from scratch, a concept from paper to a flying prototype in 117 days. This was the P-51.
Garrett said once he saw a P-51 over Berlin, he said something along the lines of, that's it, we're done, the war is lost. The Mustang quickly established its dominance in the skies of Europe, notably against Luftwaffe Mi-109s and Concorde Mi-190s. Its air superiority was evident by March of 1944. The Mustang was an essential component to the overall battle space.
Once again, B-17 and the P-51, as they did so many times over Europe. Under the bottom on in the war, that this scoop and that nozzle, that compressed air going through, actually gave the Mustang about 400 pounds of additional thrust, jet thrust, essentially. And the design of that scoop was later used in that technology on other combat aircraft, including the intake of the F-16 Fighting Falcon, which is flown today, of course, by the United States Air Force and the Minnesota Air National Guard.
lots of good metal.
Yeah, that's
like
true.
Like Inconel, Bonnell.
To make, so if you would please listen. I was looking at airplanes. His name is Finley. He has a green shirt on, or green shorts rather, blue shirt. And if you find Finley,
They flew the F-51 Mustang, the F-84 Starfighter, F-89 Scorpion, F-102 Deuce. Strength of America during the 1940s, and originally Grumman, they were building 60 Avengers a month. By the end of the war, they were producing a lot more.
My next door neighbor.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
and gentlemen, and salute to the Pacific, I give you the Grumman TV and the Avenger, the Grumman F4F Wildcat, and the Chanson F4U Corsair.
Radically altering the war's progress between 1931 and 1945. The American Invasion Force of the Pacific consisted of hundreds of thousands of soldiers supported by one of the largest armadas ever assembled. The Japanese were fighting close to their homeland, and there was no concept of surrender. The Battle of Okinawa in the spring of 1945 was the last major battle of World War II and among the bloodiest in the Pacific.
Fades into the sunset as the dramatic events of 1942 pass into history. Maybe 1943 comes into the scene to take on a man-sized job, the job of winning this war. The management of this theater pledges we will keep the planes flying, the guns booming, and all glory wins. For this theater is an American institution.
Take a look as the T-28s are now on takeoff roll. The T-28 was designed to fly like a fighter. It was from the T-28 you'd move on to me.
The final T-28 training flight took place by the Navy in early 1984. They were decommissioned from service, with many sold to private civil operators, many bringing this aircraft to air shows and events for audiences to see and hear, much like Air Expo this weekend. Veterans have served in some great stories there, and we certainly love having them and featuring them this weekend at Air Expo.
I should just lay down in the ditch.
Yeah, this is clear.
airplane, and then the last phase of that training will in the airplanes we're about to see, which are currently taking the runway off to our right-hand side. They were advanced trainers, and it was from the North American T-6 Texan that pilots would then graduate, if you will, onward to the front row fighter, say like the P-51 Mustang, P-47 Thunderbolt, or even the Corsair, just to name a few. Earlier in the show, I was making mention about those radial engines, and I'll go ahead and describe those again for you, for especially for many of you who are joining us for our second half and our afternoon flying display. Unlike the engines in our cars, these aircraft feature radial engines, and our cars as the T-6 are now on the takeoff roll. The R1340 Wasp radial engine, 600 horsepower. And now, ladies and gentlemen, in the large Vic or V formation, let's take a listen to the sound of round of the 600 horsepower radial engines and look at the sights of this five-ship formation, the North American T-6 Texans. So for people out there who want to get into flying warbirds, namely say the B-51 or the Corsair or the like, the Texan is the gateway into doing so. They said during the war that if you could
once again in the Vic formation, our Texan flight.
It does a tribute, and it's a very fine tribute indeed.
I'd be remiss not to mention also the Texans involved in Korea as well.
And after the beginning of the jet age in the Korean War, it was the first war where we saw the widespread usage of jets in the fighting role. There was a problem that those fast-moving jets had, and that was spotting targets. North American Aviation took a few of those T-6s and converted them to T-6Gs. They became spotters in the combat role. They would fly low and slow over the battlefield, spot targets of opportunity, or simply just attract ground fire. One of the modifications that North American made was the addition of underwing-mounted white phosphorus rockets, Willie Peets, as they were. Texans make their right-hand turn. They're going to be setting up to approach head-on for what is going to be a very special tribute in our show here today as we present this afternoon's missing man formation. Departing friends who gave the ultimate sacrifice in the name of freedom. Ladies and gentlemen, as our Texan flight approaches, may I ask that you please rise and join us in a moment of silence, and may we dedicate this missing man formation to those who have fallen. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for your silence.
All to one side formation as our North American T-6s approach once again from our right in the echelon formation for their threat to land.
Recover a formation flight of aircraft is via this overhead break. In the echelon formation, each aircraft breaks with 5 second intervals to position themselves the downward leg of the landing pattern. Will be placed within the crowd area, and if you're within any of the proximity of some of the taxiways, we do encourage that you pay attention to many of the volunteers. They're working around in the bright vests, and keep your head on a swivel as we bring our T-6s back in to their respective parking spots. You'll also see the Boeing B-17 Flying Fortress, Yankee Lady, returning from one of her mini rock flights here today. Pretty great.
great photo opportunity to have those T6s all lined up and that B17 coming down the line as well. And do a couple of circuits for you. We'll tell you more about the steering bike lane. Instructor would cut off the back tail of your shirt, and that is to symbolize him not having the tongue of your shirt to let alone from that point forward. In parade review from the right, here come the Boeing steermen. A variety of accounts about early headsets and where there was actually right now coming in just about as fast as these airplanes ever do fly, around 120 miles an hour. Here come the steermen. Smoke on.